Hello, and welcome back to Community Music Works Sonata Series. I'm Nina Choi, and as the curator for this series, I'm delighted to welcome you to our second Sonata event of the season. The program you are about to hear includes two iconic works from the 20th century, the Sonata for Violin and Cello by Maurice Ravel, and the Sonata for Viola and Piano by Dmitri Shostakovich are two pieces that held special significance for each composer. You'll learn more in conversations between the musicians and hear wonderful performances by resident musicians Sarah Kim, Miguel Vasquez, Sebastian Ruth, and guest artist Eliko Akahori. To learn more about the musicians, please check out their bios linked to this presentation. Thank you to everyone who made this event possible, including recording engineer Jim Moses, videographers Rebecca Atwood and Gabriel Long of Atomic Clock, Liz Cox, Kelly Reed, and of course, the musicians. And thank you, our listeners, for tuning in to this event and other events this season. I hope you enjoy the performance.
First of all, this is really fun to be sharing this program with the three of you and to be thinking about how these two pieces complement each other for a listener's experience. And certainly when we got to play through for people live, it was such an amazing sound world to hear the two pieces back to back. Maybe you want to start just with what the story of the piece is. How did it come about?
This is one of my favorite pieces. It's such a pleasure to be able to have worked on it these last couple of months. The piece was commissioned by an editor of a music magazine who commissioned pieces by 10 composers for a special edition that was dedicated to Debussy, who had passed away in 1918. And the commission took place in 1920. And so Ravel was one of the 10 composers, and then other composers included Bartok, Eric Satie, and Stravinsky, which sounds incredible. I don't know what the other pieces were on that program, but I just can't even imagine a recital with pieces by these 10 composers. The recital with these commissioned pieces took place on January 24th, 1921. And Ravel's contribution was the first movement of this duo for violin and cello. And then he didn't work on the piece again until the following year. And it was finished in 1922. And I found this really interesting. Ravel considered this piece a turning point for him in that his previous pieces had a more lush sound world to them, but he felt that this piece had a more stripped down style. He says that there was, he felt he wanted a restraint from what he called harmonic charm and more of an, he calls an emphatic reversion to the spirit of melody.
We talked about how the cello part is just always like so, like staying in the up, like very upper high register, almost matching the violin. And that on itself, it's a very interesting texture, which is hard to match. So it was very fun and interesting figuring that out, how to blend it and how to complement each other.
It's a very special sound world to be able to create with one other person, one other stringed instrument. And so it was great to be playing this with Miguel, and you can get to know people differently as you play different pieces together.
What an experimental Ravel this piece is. Because it's so focused on different instruments, that it's so limited in that sense, but then what you can create as a third instrument or something is completely different. This is sort of like a instrument, like violin cello, like whatever it is, this third instrument that it's played by this one instrument that has all those characters.
And I think that that's what, like, what still brings it back to quintessential Ravel, which with his mastery of orchestration, in which, like, you're hearing a combination of so many instruments and some doing octaves with each other and pairings that you wouldn't think of. But then when you hear it, you just hear this very beautiful and very almost like chanting, like haunting, like sound that just like kind of like completely like hypnotizes you. And I feel like that's where it maintains its Ravel quality. It's one instrument. It's not really called a duet for violin cello. It's called sonata for violin and cello.
Thank you.
Sebastian or Eliko, would one of you like to tell us the story of the piece?
I could start. We could trade a little bit back and forth, Eliko. So the Shostakovich Viola Sonata is the last piece that Shostakovich wrote in the summer of 1975, just before he died. And he wrote it for the violist of the string quartet called the Beethoven Quartet in the Soviet Union. It's three movements. And there's such a big arc in this piece. The first movement, and it's a substantial piece. I mean, it's over 30 minutes total. The first movement is starts just with a very recognizable, very memorable plucking of the open strings in the viola, the very sort of basic ingredients and on this repeated figure. So we talked about it as like a cosmic clock. It's just going to keep going, but there's also a sense, you know, you can read into it that there, he knows the clock is ticking on his life. And so it starts in this very sort of spare viola all alone quality. And then it develops as the piano comes in with this very beautiful descending melody over that spare viola plucking, and then explodes kind of in the second big theme, explodes into something quite kind of desperate and fiery. And the second movement is a quotation, a long quotation from an opera that he wrote and never finished in the 40s called The Gamblers. And The Gamblers was taken from a text by Gogol, a Russian writer, about these card players, one of whom was trying to cheat the other two, and then, or three, and then they were trying to cheat him, and eventually they decided to form an alliance and go and cheat other people. Well, it turned out the original group had included everybody in their conspiracy to cheat the first guy out of his money. So there's this very sort of, again, this sarcastic, little bit bitter, a little bit comical quality. And Shostakovich never finished the opera, although people have performed the one act he wrote. But there's this very high energy, but not joyous quality, I think. And Shostakovich said it was a kind of a scherzo movement, like a joke, but again, with this bitter quality. And then maybe the heart of the work is the last movement, where it ends in an adagio and it ends in a slow movement. And the viola again starts alone with, again, a sort of mournful descending line. And then when the piano comes in, it's a quotation of Beethoven, the Moonlight Sonata, the piano sonata. And then the viola adds to that. And there's this, that becomes this through line of that movement. In the very, very last days of his life, he's having written so much music, he's quoting Beethoven. There's something very kind of out of time about ending that.
In a way, and it's a huge arc that, as Sebastian said, the first movement when the pizzicato opening starts, that to me, it's like a heart beating, but it's very clockwise, like it's heart beating and he knows its time is coming. But then last movement, there's no mentioning, it's the timeless quality that last movement achieves after coming that clock ticking in first movement, and then second movement being sort of sarcastic, as if that he was desperate to know time is ticking and ticking in the first movement. And the second movement, well, I have to do something. I don't have enough time. I have to do something to like to show that I lived or I mattered, or so then it's really energetic and active, but very sarcastic. But then in third movement, it's really that somehow he found his own way, reconciled with everything that he has gone through, and he knows this fate is inescapable, and therefore the kind of redemption and the reflection of his life that ends, it creates this timeless quality and the gorgeous forever waited for. We have been longing for this gorgeous moment at the very end after 40 minutes of playing, is this gorgeous prolonged C major chord that shows what he has gone through his life. And I feel privileged for us to have this gift, start from the heartbeat ticking to that ending of the feeling of endless feeling, and somehow this, yeah, this is life. This is in my life is okay. And I feel very lucky to be able to feel that in 40 minutes of music. And you can experience over and over each time you play. I just cannot, it's as if like I've lived different life again. No, there are not so many pieces that I feel that way by playing from the beginning to the end. In the rehearsal, Sebastian and I were talking about it, and how different time of your life, when you revisit the same piece, how you feel differently. Mm-hmm. And I was saying that, you know, in my early 20s, when I first played this piece, I had no clue. And then it's little by little, every time it's getting somewhere or not getting anywhere maybe, but being aware of that. And it has been a while that I have played this piece and this time with Sebastian. And so we were saying, well, maybe in 30 years, that if we play together, you know, that might strike a different conversation, and I'm looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Thank you.